Hi everyone, my name is Pablo Leone. I'm a medical oncologist at Dana-Farber Cancer Institute, and I'm going to be talking today a little bit about breast cancer in men, which is a rare disease overall. It represents less than 1% of breast cancers in the United States, but that amounts to many hundreds of men being diagnosed per year in this country with breast cancer. And so it is common that both for patients and oncologists, there are many questions that come up when they have to be part of the treatment of this disease. And that often comes from the lack of data in this space due to the rarity of the breast cancer diagnosed, of this type of breast cancer diagnosis. So there are, in general, there are several risk factors that men can have for developing breast cancer, which are very similar to the risk factors for women. And that includes aging. So patients that are older have a higher risk of developing breast cancer, and that is true both for men and for women. Many of the regular risk factors that we consider for women are similar in men, such as obesity, inactivity, excessive alcohol intake, smoking, family history of breast cancer, hereditary mutations, genetic mutations that are hereditary, such as mutations in BRCA1 or 2, hereditary breast and ovarian cancer syndrome can affect both women and men in a similar manner and be a risk factor for both in a similar manner. There are, however, some risk factors that are unique to men that have to do with the imbalance of testosterone and or androgens and estrogens. So there are conditions such as Klinefelter syndromes, for example, that are a risk factor for developing breast cancer in men that do not apply to women. Exposure to carcinogens is a risk factor that is common to both as well. So a few things to keep in mind when we as physicians have to treat a patient that is a man with breast cancer. One very important one is to make sure that we offer genetic counseling and genetic testing for men. For any man with a diagnosis of breast cancer, and then think about the treatment options that are best for them. Most men with breast cancer present with ER-positive, HER2-negative breast cancer, and oftentimes a discussion is made about the type of surgery that men will undergo, whether it is a lumpectomy or a total mastectomy. There is data supporting the safety of using lumpectomy in men with very early stage breast cancer and breast conservation in those patients. But oftentimes when men present with breast cancer because there's no screening for it, the patients may present with a larger primary tumor or a tumor that is very large for the breast size. And in those scenarios, it's common that men will undergo a total mastectomy for the treatment. Aside from that, then there are the considerations for systemic therapy, obviously, and in some regards, there are many similarities to the way we approach the treatment for women with breast cancer, where we consider tests like Oncotype or MammaPrint as necessary if those are to be helpful for informing the decision of adjuvant therapies. The role of chemotherapy and the agents that we use are similar between men and women. The biggest difference in the systemic therapy between men and women with breast cancer is with regards to the use of hormonal therapy, specifically tamoxifen, which is the standard of care for the treatment of men with ER-positive breast cancer. And this is a difference compared with women, where in postmenopausal women with breast cancer, the standard is the use of an aromatase inhibitor for adjuvant therapy. Tamoxifen can also be used, but aromatase inhibitors are in general preferred. In men with breast cancer, we do not have that distinction by menopausal status, and the standard endocrine therapy of choice is tamoxifen. Oftentimes, we get the question of why is that the case, and there are a number of reasons why. The first one is that the data that supports the use of tamoxifen, which is observational data, shows that men who undergo treatment with tamoxifen do better, have better survival outcomes than those who do not do tamoxifen in the adjuvant setting. And that was in part what established tamoxifen as the standard of care in men. There are very few studies that have looked at outcomes for aromatase inhibitors in men with breast cancer. And some of those studies have shown that aromatase inhibitors may be inferior compared with tamoxifen, but those are not definitive studies. In fact, the sample sizes are very small. There are also potential biological concerns with the use of aromatase inhibitors in men, in which there could be, by using an aromatase inhibitor, there could be the generation of a feedback loop that leads to higher levels of testosterone production and androgens production in men. And those androgens could be converted to estrogens despite of the activity of the aromatase inhibitors. And that could lead to higher levels of estrogen through that feedback loop that could in turn be less effective as a treatment option for men with ER-positive breast cancer compared with tamoxifen. So it is important to consider that the data does support the use of tamoxifen, but also very important to keep in mind that there are very legitimate questions, in fact, as to the activity of aromatase inhibitors. And specifically, there are many case reports published and also case series that have looked at activity of aromatase inhibitors in men, documenting activity even in the metastatic setting. So it's actually, in fact, quite possible that aromatase inhibitors may have a role in the treatment of male breast cancer, and we need more research to learn from this and be able to inform our patients and improve the care for men with breast cancer. So we talked a little bit about systemic therapy. Another consideration is with regards to the use of radiation therapy. And this is a discussion that has to be that has to take place in the treatment of breast cancer in men, particularly for patients who meet criteria for radiation therapy, which are very similar to the criteria that we apply in women. So there is an integral part of radiation oncology as well in the discussion for the treatment for these patients. The other subtypes of breast cancer in men are more uncommon. So the HER2-positive subtype of breast cancer in men represents approximately around 12% or 11% of all breast cancers in the United States. So it is a more rare subtype, but again, for medical oncologists who do see breast cancer, they will eventually see men who do have HER2-positive disease. We do use the anti-HER2 therapies as part of the systemic therapy option for men in a similar manner as we do in women as well. The most rare subtype of breast cancer in men is triple negative breast cancer. In fact, it accounts for around 2% or less of all breast cancers in men. And the follow-up of men with breast cancer is also important. It is important to counsel patients on the side effects of tamoxifen, for example, and how the side effects may be different, or some of the side effects may be different. So some of the side effects are similar to those that we see in women, and some are very different and very unique to men. So side effects of tamoxifen that are similar between men and women include hot flashes and menopausal symptoms. And it is important to counsel men about this because men are not used to experiencing these symptoms as a normal life. And they can be challenging when using drugs like tamoxifen, for example. Fatigue is also a side effect that is commonly reported when patients are on tamoxifen, and that side effect is seen both in men and women similarly. Another side effect that is common to both men and women is the risk of blood clots, of DVTs, thromboembolic events. However, men have a slightly higher tendency than women in general for developing blood clots. And so it is a side effect that is important to counsel patients on for that, so that patients are vigilant about this risk and also that they remain active as a method of prevention of this as well. Then there are a few side effects that are unique to men, and those are specifically sexual related side effects, such as impotence and loss of libido. Impotence is a side effect that men can experience on tamoxifen, and it is important to counsel men about the real possibility of them experiencing this side effect and how to manage it, and educate patients on how to manage it as well. And it is important to counsel patients, men and women, about the relevance of adherence to endocrine therapy and how important it is, how important endocrine therapy is in the landscape of the treatments for breast cancer, how effective it is, and how important it is to be able to complete the necessary treatment. Adherence to endocrine therapy can be low in many patients, and in fact, in general, in women, it's quoted to be somewhere between 70% for endocrine therapy in general, 70 to 80%. In men, there have been a few studies looking at that as well, and there are also issues with regards to adherence to endocrine therapy in men. Some studies have actually reported even lower than 70% rates of adherence to endocrine therapy for men with breast cancer. So it is important to counsel patients on this. We at Dana-Farber are very fortunate to count with a program that is dedicated for breast cancer in men. It's our Dana-Farber program for breast cancer in men. And this program has very unique opportunities. So it counts with dedicated experts in the fields of surgery, radiation oncology, medical oncology, who have experience in managing breast cancer in men, who treat many men with breast cancer on a daily basis even. And we see many men with breast cancer at Dana-Farber. So the program that we have is trying to also improve the treatments for men with this disease. We're trying to understand more the unique things about breast cancer in men, how to understand the differences, the biologic differences between breast cancer in men and in women, how the treatments that we have may have different efficacies in men versus women with breast cancer. We're also trying to understand and move forward the next generation of treatments for breast cancer specific to men, and also to try to improve beyond tamoxifen, which is the standard of care for breast cancer in men since tamoxifen has been invented. So we do have a clinical trial that we're planning to open very soon, where we're going to test different endocrine therapies in men with breast cancer. And specifically, we're going to compare tamoxifen versus aromatase inhibitors with gonadal suppression to try to understand whether a treatment option other than tamoxifen may be better than tamoxifen, and to try to understand more about the many decades old question of whether aromatase inhibitors may be an option for treatment of men with breast cancer, or whether tamoxifen should continue to be the standard treatment for this population. The trial will enroll men with ER-positive breast cancer who have an intact primary tumor, and we will do a window of opportunity study where we test the efficacy of these drugs for the reduction of the biomarker that is Ki-67, and that will inform us on the activity of these agents in men. Men ultimately go for surgery as per standard of care, and we're hoping that this information will be very helpful in refining the endocrine therapy options for men with breast cancer. The trial is also trying to understand what is the best endocrine therapy backbone for men who will need treatment with CDK4/6 inhibitors as well. So right now, because tamoxifen is the only standard of care option for men, or the main standard of care option for men with ER-positive breast cancer, we want to know whether tamoxifen may be the best endocrine therapy backbone to combine with CDK4/6 inhibitors versus aromatase inhibitors with gonadal suppression plus CDK4/6 inhibitors. So we're very excited about our program. We're very excited for the work that we do with our colleagues at Breast Oncology in Dana-Farber every day to try to improve the lives of men with breast cancer. And we're very excited about the clinical trial to try to move the field forward for the treatment of this disease in men. So with that, I thank you very much for your attention.